I get knocked down, but I get up again. You're never gonna keep me down. Well, confused? A little bit. So now today we are here to talk about ringtones, how they've evolved over the years, and how it has actually transformed from being a simple monophonic ringtone to a polyphonic ringtone, and how over the years it has transformed to being the kind of avatar it is in today. We'll talk about and how we can draw parallels from the development of ringtone to what we see today in terms of technological and economic development. In terms of metaphor itself, we see that the growth and development of ringtone can be compared to, could be a metaphor for the technological development, the economic development, as well as the emergence of open source. So let us try and look at what these three things are one at a time. Talking about technological development now. Ringtone has transformed like from almost a BP to an MP3 sound that is today. How did it all start? It all started with combining music and technology. There was some person somewhere in the world, most of in Japan, who thought about, okay, how can we probably come up with something that can make music and technology come together? And then we had the IC chips. So we started moving from the monophonic to the polyphonic ringtones, to the MP3s, to the video ringtones that we have together, as well as the quality. So these IC chips were developed by Yamaha, firstly to use in their synthesizers. So synthesizers, if somebody does not know here, is the keyboard instrument that musicians play. So they developed these chips to digitize the sound of a piano, to how they can probably expand the market over there. And then very successfully, Nokia thought, hey, can we use those chips in our handset? And when they did, they came up with the polyphonic ringtones, and then they really took that forward. And it also led to, there was again a lot of technological developments happening across Europe and US as well. So with these developments, there was a geographical convergence of technology as well. Now again, talking about economic development, Keshav, could you take that?
Yeah. As Mohit rightly mentioned, any technological development is also spearheaded with economic growth. So let's just take a look at how the telecommunication industry was. So basically, for a telecom industry, there are two important components. One obviously will be the service provider, and the second part will be the handset or the instrument manufacturer. This is how the traditional industry used to be. So with the advent of ringtone, what happened was this. The whole landscape was just changing. So there was one more element, this is ringtone. To bring this to reality, what were the features that are required? So first it begins with the content developer. So the content developer himself will be the big studios, music studios like Sony or Universal themselves. So first they serve to be the content providers, and next in the ladder for value creation will be aggregators. So what aggregators usually do is they source all these contents, that is the ringtones, based upon various journals and various music labels, and they try to accumulate all these in a form, and this is made available to the users. So now our user will be in a position to choose from all the available ringtones that are provided. Based upon his own personalization, and his own taste, he tends to choose them. So after this aggregator, that will be a service provider, and service provider usually are the telecom providers themselves. And one more thing is that there will also be a billing agency. So with the advent of one single element of ringtone, these many players are introduced into the ecosystem. What basically is this? First, there is new markets are created in specific categories evolved. So Sony, which used to be a music label, now is a content generator for ringtones in handset. So the new categories are created, new opportunities are made, and there is a great scope for economic development. And next again, it's going to continue.
So talking about ringtones as a metaphor for emergence of open source. So progressed were from being the normal tring-tring to the polyphonic ringtones to the MP3 ringtones to video ringtones, and there was a whole craze around these ringtones. Everyone wanted the best, the newest, latest ringtone in their phone. But with the advent in technology, the people could actually manage to provide these ringtones for free. Instead of paying for every download, people could get these ringtones for free. So we have seen this case in every technology. If we look at Microsoft, it started with its operating system, it started with Microsoft Office. All these were paid services. The intention was that whatever you're creating, users need to pay for it. But increase in technology helps you to reach a level, make money out of it, and then you will eventually end up with free sources like Linux with its operating system. Similar is the case with mobile applications. These days, no one is willing to pay for a mobile application of any kind. While when they started, it was such a big thing, such a big hit that everyone was willing to pay anything for it. So now the source of revenue generation is advertisements rather than the product itself. So if we look at the life cycle of any technology, and if we compare it with the industrial development, so if I take industrial development here, and here if I take the technology growth, so the technology or the industry will improve initially. When the technology is new, the industry will flourish, but there will be a point in time when that technology gets trampled upon by new technologies. That is when you need to start providing that technology for free, and that is when that industry tramples and new industries take over. So looking at a dialectical analysis of the text on ringtones,
hey, check out my new Rolex. You know what? I bought a new Lambo and a 100 feet yacht.
God, where? How did you get the money from?
You know what? You people make good music, and me being a creator, I just sell it out and I make tons and tons of money.
Damn! I had a similar story with Yamaha as well. Yamaha made great IC chips, and then Nokia just put them in their hands and made truckloads of money. Man, this is failure.
So looking at this situation, the case of surplus value is in this case that the people who are manufacturing the technology, who are inventing the technology, are not the ones who are getting the major chunk of the profits. In the entire value chain, the major profits are going to the end user, the final owners of the technology who are taking it to the end user. So in this, like we see that Yamaha is making the chips, but Nokia is getting the money. The recording studios are making the music, but the aggregators are making money out of it. Now let's talk about the class and class struggle.
Hey, did you hear? I just met a friend of mine. He's an aggregator, he's making so much money, man. And I even heard that news about Nokia. Man, we need to do something about this.
We make the music, but they sell it.
What are you discussing about?
I mean, these people are making so much money. What should we do about this?
We can't let them do that. I mean, it's our thing. We are making the music. Let's make a cartoon.
I know.
We can't let them take all the margins. Let us take all the margins.
We take the greater bite from the pie.
Yes. We make a cartoon.
So,
moving on to the class level. That is, as you see here, the first structure, in the first environment, the aggregators had a major chunk because they thought they are the source for every single market. But later, the content provider realized that they are the true source of content. Unless until they generate some ringtones, and there won't be anything for these aggregators to sell upon. So they learn that part and they try to exploit further. So after this after this scenario, the content developer tend to have a greater chance. Or for every ringtone that was sold, now they tend to have they claim 40 to 50% of the total margin. So this is how the one who owns or commands the value chain tends to get more chance or try to enjoy the surplus.
Talking about the next phenomenon, that is fetishism.
Polyphony
ringtone. Let's go. Great. Awesome, dude. Just show me this. Amazing phone. Where did you get this from?
The best phone in the market from Universal, I believe.
Great. This is amazing. Can you show me more polyphonic tubes? Is that MPG?
See, this is how you get cool, you sarkari fool. So this is what fetishism is all about, right? Now you see that what did it start from? A ringtone, and it slowly became a status symbol. It percolated down into the mindset of people. We saw it became an intrinsic property of not just the phone, but of the person as well. It started defining, started defining the personal aspects of the person. Another example, and before we go to that, people even started paying premiums for ringtones. I mean, here was one phone that with which you can make a phone call, you can send your messages and all of the regular stuff. But here was another phone with polyphonic ringtones, and well, people are ready to pay more for this. And another example of things having intrinsic property, the Nokia tube, the grand walls as it is called. Now, as Nokia started selling a lot of phones with their polyphonic ringtones, this became the Nokia tube. Everyone started identifying not just phone calls with the Nokia tune, not just phone with the Nokia tune. The grand walls became the tune for Nokia. So this is what fetishism is all about.
Talking next about the ideology depicted in this case. So as we can see, the growth in ringtones, the advancement in technology, it depicts a free market ideology where anyone is allowed to actually grow by making new technologies, by doing well, you can actually grow to the top and displace the leader. Also, anyone in the reigning position has that fear and that insecurity of being overpowered by an upcoming technology. So there is this intrinsic free market ideology over here. Also, the case mentioned that with the advancement of ringtone business, there was a major shift from people being phone sex providers to ringtone providers. So that is the kind of ideology or the free market or the freedom that people had to actually move around within the ecosystem. So looking at the form and content of this text, it appears as if technological growth and economic development is good for all. I mean, what can go wrong? Like IC chips were invented, digital keyboards came into place, there was an emergence of several industries as Keshav pointed out. But it also led to the obsolescence of a lot of industries and a lot of skill sets. Talking about skill sets, as I mentioned, people shifted from the phone sex industry to the ringtone provider industry. And obviously there is a lot of difference in the skill sets required for phone sex and for ringtones. Also, there was the end of several industries. So people were thriving on the fact that customers will be ready to pay for ringtones because it has become a part of their personality. As soon as people stopped paying for ringtones, as soon as ringtones became free, the entire industry of service providers and billing people vanished. Also, because of the growth in technology, there is the accumulation of a lot of e-waste. Everyone wants the latest, everyone wants what is the fashion in technology. So even if I have a phone which is good enough to make phone calls and make SMSs, I want another one which can do MMSs, and then another one which is Android, and then I need an iPhone. So there is a lot of accumulation of e-waste.
I think we need to explain that with an example. So see, if you can look at this example, with the advent of steam engine came the Industrial Revolution. The way industries functioned in Europe changed. Now it led to a lot of development, of course, as we know. Especially in the textile industry, if we talk again, take it home, the Indian textile industry. So slowly as steam engine started replacing artisans in the textile industry, then it led to a lot of loss of jobs for them. Moreover, since the production capacity started increasing for textile industry, they started demanding more raw material from the raw material producers. So this in turn led to people started shifting from producing food crops to cash crops, which was a huge blow for an agrarian economy such as India. So, and thus really hampered our development moving forward.
Yeah. Now let's try to find out one more classical example which is very similar to the ringtone. That is, we try to understand the locomotor signal and its associative industries. So, we will first understand what, how the locomotive industry evolved over the process of time. First, there was the internal combustion engines, and the invention of internal combustion engines plus availability of petrol made it a big success. Let's look a little more deep into petrol. First, petrol was believed to be like a herb that can be used for medicinal purpose. Then they found out this is not a very viable option. Second option for petrol, they thought this can be used in lamps. So after the Thomas Alva Edison invented electric bulbs, no more was the need for lamps that day. So then again, after the invent of internal combustion engines, petrol was the only ultimate source as well as diesel. So this is the total industry and its associated industry assets for a locomotive. And over a period of time, after internal combustion engines, there was also incorporation of DTS, digital twin spark ignition. So plus the petrol. So what this means is that with the invention of DTSI, the combustion rate increase and the efficiency or the output from the combustion increase. Over time, as technology progresses, now we stand in a advent where we are now we are capable to use electric cells or electric cars even. So we are familiar. I hope everyone would be familiar with the current situation that Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla, he open sourced every single of his patent so that electric cars could be foreseeable in future, and he made sure that any competitor of his can use his patent so that electric cars are rolled out in the near future. And there are also hybrid models, which is a trade-off between both these things. And one more thing about this is that electric cars, what is this? Too catchy about this? First thing is, they are environment friendly. So, you call about carbon emission, that is the most important drawback of petrols, carbon monoxide emission. That is the one important thing which is bugging all the environmentalists all around the globe. So, with electric cars, the emission can be controlled. Second thing is that, every day we see two things are growing, our expense, second petrol prices. So, petrol prices are going up, so we need one more alternate solution where we can spend little less. So, if we try to use electric fuel cells, these are rechargeable, so they tend to have a very long time and the cost incurred over it will also be little less. So, these are the importance of the current technologies throughout in the locomotive sector. Manu, please.
Okay, so let us try and analyze this case in terms of form and content. Alright, well, as Keshav will pointed out, electric cars create a win-win situation for us. How does it create a win-win situation for the consumer? We've seen it is cheaper, again, for the society at best, it is environmental friendly. Even for the manufacturers, although, of course, they would have to shift from the manufacturing facilities that they have for petrol cars to electric cars. But think about this. When do we change our cars? Probably every 4-5 years when they really get old. But here would be a technology that is actually going to replace an existing technology. So almost everybody would slowly start switching over it, which would lead to higher sales. So at the surface of it all, it is creating a win-win situation for all. But is it? As Keshav explained, petrol grew because of the internal combustion engine which burns petrol. The entire petroleum industry is based on that. So once we take that out, the entire petroleum industry collapses. And if it does, what happens to the OPEC nations? There are a lot of nations which thrive only on their petroleum exports. Their entire economies would collapse. Again, if you talk about car manufacturers, so as I said earlier, although they would have a lot of cars to sell, but they would need to upgrade a lot of their manufacturing facilities. And if you take one step down from there, if you talk about the workers working in the car factories, you would realize that since the technology would change, so would the skill set required of the workers would also change. And this would mean a lot of laying off. And lastly, again, we've seen the kind of fall petroleum industry. might witness, or my word, would witness.
So, would it not lead to cartelization from not just the huge petroleum producing countries, the huge petroleum producing companies who have a lot of political clout all over the world? Would it not lead to cartelization from all of them and the reluctance to not invest into technologies such as this and not let the world move to a cleaner, cleaner and more efficient way of transportation?
So, to sum it all up, we have seen that technology, as it grows, it replaces other technologies. We have seen the form and content. We have seen the good and bad of technological development, of economic development. But as I heard a surgeon say, to heal, you need to make a cut. So if any new technology comes up, it definitely does trample upon the old existing technologies. But in order to progress, in order to do well, you always need to keep inventing and keep catching up with the new technologies. Only then can we actually progress.
Thank you.